All right, we are ready to begin. Welcome to tonight's lecture by the Reverend Dr. Lisa Dayhill, titled Rewilding Christian Worship. My name is Tim Kyle, and I direct the Lutheran Studies program here at the Divinity School. We are pleased that you came, and also welcome those attending on Zoom. My particular thanks also to Jeff Payswinkle of the Institute of Sacred Music for providing technological assistance. To center us in this place together and in its roots with those who have preceded us, I invite Dan Pfluger to please read Yale Divinity School's land acknowledgement.
Yale University acknowledges that Indigenous peoples and nations, including Mohegan, Mashantucket, Pequot, Eastern Pequot, Shkatokok, Golden Hill, Paugusset, Niantic, and the Quinnipiac, and other Algonquin-speaking peoples, have stewarded through the generations the lands and waterways of what is now the state of Connecticut. We honor and respect the enduring relationship that exists between these peoples and nations and this land. The Divinity School recognizes the role that Christianity played in colonization movements and repudiates the work or the use of Christianity or any other religion for the purposes of oppression. We encourage all the work for justice in the aftermath of colonization and to reject racism and anti-Indigenous attitudes in all forms.
Thank you, Dan. Now to our presenter. Dr. Dayhill is Miriam Therese Winter Professor of Transformative Leadership and Spirituality and Director of the Center for Transformative Spirituality at Hartford International University. I can't say that in one breath. And is the inaugural faculty member in that program, joining HIU this past fall. Dr. Dayhill has a long career in teaching, most recently at California Lutheran University in Thousand Oaks, California, previously for many years at Trinity Lutheran Seminary in Columbus, Ohio. She earned a bachelor's degree from Gustavus Adolphus College. Somebody should be here to give a shout out about that, in St. Peter, Minnesota, a Master of Divinity degree from the Lutheran School of Theology at Chicago. I'll give a shout out to that because we go way back there with my wife, Kari. Earned a PhD in Christian spirituality from the Graduate Theological Union in Berkeley, California, and is a pastor in the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America. Her teaching and research in worship, spirituality, and theology have made her a notable scholar of the theology of Dietrich Bonhoeffer and eco-theology, with publications on each of those subjects, and coming soon, a book on the intersection between Bonhoeffer and ecology. That should be exciting. Tonight, we will engage in the topic of rewilding, applying liturgical and contemplative traditions related to multi-species, which will find its way into a publication titled Jesus in the Earth, Rewilding Christian Spirituality. Lisa is passionate about finding her way to rivers and oceans for recreation, among other places. I am pleased to call Lisa my friend and happy also to have met her pug, Tiger, and shared recreational activities since she has relocated to the East. Let us together welcome Dr. Lisa Dayhill.
Thank you, Tim. Good to be here. I'm grateful and honored with this invitation. Thanks to all of you who've come and all those who are online. I lost my voice this week, so I'm going to try to speak into the microphone and hope everyone can hear. If anyone can't hear online, just put that in the chat and our tech wizard will help. So the talk is called Rewilding Christian Worship, and I have five theses. So not 95, just five. So for some time, I've been exploring what happens when Christian liturgy moves outdoors into engagement with the more than human natural world. Living in a time of urgent ecological crisis, Christians need outdoor ritual experience of their faith, of what is wild, of the living earth, stranger faces of the divine, taking eco-alienated people out of the building and into the streets, the river, the forest. Moving liturgy outdoors makes possible an opening to both human and more than human strangeness on their own terms in actual present sensory experience. Why are there church walls at all? That delineation of space treated as sacred from what isn't serves as a metaphor for all the splitting, the two-nesses, not just us within delineated from them outside on a human level, but more fundamentally, what was variably one sacred reality now divided into a hushed, beautiful, holy realm, the sanctuary, versus the honking, polluted, degraded, real world, so-called, outside. Those church walls are a question, a symbolic problem. Indoor enclosure, of course, is essential for what it allows us to experience of the arts, of welcome, of symbols, of safety, encompassing all the way back to the wombs, too, in which our lives first gestate, to the political refuge given to those fleeing oppression, to the literal shelter our mortal bodies and those who are homeless so desperately need. Yet such indoorness is not the only primary location metaphor of our faith. We need outdoor experience too, of what is wild, of earth itself, of the world in its strangeness, of the other, of the God who breaks all images and language, meeting us endlessly in what is not us, taking us out of security, outside the city walls, into the wilderness. Taking liturgy literally outdoors both proclaims the necessity of and makes possible the assembly's opening beyond itself to this non-human strangeness on its own terms. Outdoor ministry sites testify to the transforming power of encounter with God in and with creation, not mediated by church walls. Yet for most North American Christians, worship is an almost exclusively indoor phenomenon, or increasingly taking place within a new set of virtual layers, even more impermeable to the rest of the natural world. When COVID first struck, congregations by and large shut down their in-person worship, and many quickly pivoted to online content, perhaps presenting readings and prayers and music and reflections from home or church offices, at some point perhaps migrating back into the sanctuary to lead services with no worshipers present. Many congregations found their return to in-person worship in that surreal summer and fall of 2020, taking place outdoors, and people began to gather, not only in the outdoor chapels they may already have had for summer worship, if they were lucky, but also on church lawns and nearby parks. For a while, I thought COVID might actually become an odd release from all that indoorness, inviting us much more fully out for good. But with rare exceptions, that seems not to have taken place. Most congregations have returned, mostly vaccinated and maybe still masking, to their in-person worship context while continuing the live streaming that allows others not to leave their homes at all as they watch from within their own walls the worship taking place within the church walls, all of this mediated by that peculiar perceptual disembodiment and radical disorientation from where I actually am in the flesh that is virtuality. As eco-philosopher David Abram puts it, virtual reality, quote, works by dissolving distance entirely, detaching us from our sensory embedment in a particular place in order to dialogue with other minds that have similarly withdrawn from their senses. The more we participate with these astonishing technologies right here tonight, right? The more we seal ourselves into an exclusively human cocoon, and the more our animal senses, co-evolved with the winds, the waters, and the many-voiced terrain, are blunted, rendering us ever more blind, ever more deaf, ever more impervious to the more-than-human earth. End quote. Scholars of liturgy are attempting to think with this sudden broad-scale ecclesial movement into virtual reality, this live streaming Sunday after Sunday. But hardly any question the fundamental assumption of indoorness itself as a primary feature of Christian worship. The assumption of a built sanctuary within which worship takes place is more or less universal. Even liturgical theologies that point to the so-called inside-out nature of Christian worship, the walls of the sanctuary perceptually dissolving so that we find ourselves sent into a world and creation already met and redeemed in love, orient this perspective from experiences of divine encounter that still take place indoors so as then to go out. My own reflection emerges out of decades of experience and love of indoor liturgical traditions. I have no desire to diminish their healing power and human significance. But powerful experiences of the natural world as well as outdoor worship of many kinds has pushed me to ask the further question of what difference it makes when not only liturgical perception moves inside out, but when the entire liturgy itself does. I think about this question not only in the sorts of words and images that mark this presentation or my scholarship on these questions, but primarily liturgically through participation, design, and leadership of outdoor rites themselves, and which I'm happy to talk about in the Q&A if you wish. Ultimately, rites located paradigmatically both indoors and out best reflect my conviction that the fullest revelation of God is found when we experience these primary locations not divided but held gracefully together in some way, one vast rite of word and sacrament. But we've had so many centuries of indoor-only worship that for a while at least it might be salutary to consider taking extended time in outdoor-only contexts. We need worship that restores our primal, perceptual, and spiritual connections to that living world in real time at the worshiping heart of our faith. The Wild Church Network, whose image is in the bottom right of the slide, and some other images from their the Raven and the Wild Seekers from the Wild Church Network website. A communion of communities doing just that, seeing what happens when the sanctuary is the larger natural world, the worshiping community, including creeping and flying and mossy and arboreal boughs of all kinds. I will share a story of a Wild Church liturgy later. Moving worship and the practices of faith outdoors is not the only way to restore and deepen these connections, but it may be the most powerful, making possible an opening to this larger sacred wild in our own bodily experience. This talk is a piece of my broader scholarship, as Tim noted, exploring non-dualistic forms of spirituality that draw us into this larger wild communion of beings, into the bark and scales and fur of interspecies life itself. Here is the divine presence, and we live here too. So I'm framing this talk through two presuppositions and five theses. So two presuppositions. First, so the first one, God and world are one reality in Jesus Christ. First presupposition. One of Dietrich Bonhoeffer's most surprising assertions, which I've spent decades sitting inside, was his refusal of any dichotomizing of reality, even from within the conspiracy and his work against Hitler, refusing any dichotomizing of good versus evil, God versus world. In his ethics, he begins the whole work by insisting that God and world are not two dueling realities, but one reality in Jesus Christ. Any conceptions that split God from world into two separate realms thereby create abstractions of each, he asserts. Instead, there are not two realities, but only one reality. He considers God-world dualism, or a dualism of realms, God and world as separate realms, as the sickness infesting most of Christian history, a quote, colossus obstructing our way, end quote. The dominant theological conception after the New Testament, he asserts, has been, quote, the basic conception of two realms that bump against each other, one divine, holy, supernatural, the other worldly, profane, natural, end quote. He continues, quote, reality as a whole splits into two parts in this way, and thus the concern of Christ becomes merely a partial provincial affair within the whole of reality. One reckons, that is, with realities outside the reality of Christ, end quote. Bonhoeffer does not develop these insights ecologically, but I'm working with this striking repudiation of God-world dualism eco-theologically in this book I'm writing, developing these insights, and tonight we'll explore them liturgically. I want to take seriously this non-dual, mutual Christological inherence of God and world. What does that actually mean, and how does it challenge, recast, and rewild our inherited patterns of spirituality and worship? This line of thought resonates with theologies of deep incarnation, as well as with the visionary work of Thomas Barry up there on the screen, Willie Jennings here at Yale on eco-settlers and other non-natives as second readers of this land. Mary Jane Rubenstein at Wesleyan in her pan-theologies, Gods, Worlds, and Monsters, also much new materialist work, Donna Haraway's Lethal Tentacularity, or Jane Bennett's proposal of vital matter, all that is participating in emergent quantum weirdness, entangled and alive all the way down, God and world, one reality. Environmental ethicist Lisa Sedaris was an early voice to call for theology to reflect scientific insight from biology in particular, much more rigorously. And David Abram insists on a way of thinking, quote, that strives for rigor without forfeiting our animal kinship with the world around us, an attempt to think in accordance with the senses, to ponder and reflect without severing our sensorial bond with the owls and the wind, end quote. I hear Bonhoeffer's insistence on one reality as the conviction of this fundamental coherence between theology and the biological sciences. And my work has to do with taking up this challenge, learning to pray and worship too, without forfeiting our animal kinship with the world around us, without severing our sensorial bond with the owls and the wind. Ultimately, recovering a sense of the holiness of all that is requires our becoming literate again in what the ancient church called the first book of God, namely the created world spoken by the same logos wisdom as the scriptures. We have let fears of pantheism lock us into the suicidal and desolating splitting of holiness from world for far too long, I believe. Bonhoeffer, Rubenstein, Abram, and many others are challenging that taboo, making thinkable what I call a second naivete pantheism, also forms of Christian animism that open the door to whole new aspects of Christian experience. So presupposition number one, God and world, one reality, not two. And then second presupposition, worship is meant to correspond to reality, which is a bedrock of liturgical studies. Liturgy is meant to open us to the real. It's about revelation and experientially taking in what is deemed to be true. It's what rituals do. So this language of correspondence with reality also comes from Bonhoeffer in his Ethics. As he asserts the necessary alignment between our theological convictions or ethical frameworks and this overarching reality of Jesus Christ, God and world, one reality. So in terms of worship, we know, of course, how profoundly liturgical experience frames worldview and belief, often at pre-verbal or even pre-conscious levels, shaping how we think, how we see. I appreciate the work of liturgical scholar Ben Stewart in demonstrating this, and I forgot to, because I'm trying to put images up of people, and I forgot to get Ben up here. So he studies how powerfully the form, or has written on how powerfully the form of people's baptismal experience, whether they were immersed or sprinkled, shapes their spontaneous, untutored articulation of what baptism means. Adults who went through the process of confirmation and baptism. Thus, the practice of indoor worship, too, I assert, however powerfully enacted, does not necessarily translate in people's deep symbolic imagination into the sort of radical spiritual ecological immersion into the actual local watershed and the largest belonging of life to life on earth that we need today. What would non-dualistic liturgical formation into that sensorial bond with owls and wind, what would worship that corresponds with that fullness of wild reality look like and feel like and taste like? So tonight is a thought experiment to respond to this question, an attempt to think liturgically in the fullest ecological correspondence with reality. What happens to think liturgically with Bonhoeffer's conviction of God and world as one reality in Jesus Christ? So what follows the five theses may at times sound profoundly Christian to you, wildly Christian, or it may sound not Christian at all. We'll see. So see what you think. What is lost and what is gained when worship moves outdoors? So first section, calling the first section the wild fullness of the incarnation, liturgical assembly. Hold on. So Christians cherish how Jesus in flesh incarnates God, this great puzzle in the Western mind. How can God become mortal flesh filled with blood like any piece of meat? We paint paintings of the Annunciation because we sense that what Mary did, saying yes to this interweaving of God and mortal flesh, really is the salvation of the world. Re-knitting together that dualism. Yet as much as we love this story and the incarnation as Christians, somehow we're still caught in this ancient separation. Do you truly treat your body as if its very cells are filled with God, as holy as the sacramental bread and wine you take into those cells? Your body? So holy? Do we even grasp what Bonhoeffer is saying about reality? In Christ, God and the world are not separate, but one Chalcedonian reality. The larger life of the natural world, its countless species and gut microbes and blades of grass, all made of God, the flesh of God, to be encountered and treated as primary divine revelations. Modern biology teaches what ancient theology pondered, that if we're going to cherish the divine inherence in some piece of creation, say the flesh of Jesus of Nazareth, then the same is true of the whole biosphere. Because there's no physical separation between beings. We all eat and drink one another's body and blood in every moment, every day. The water molecules in Jesus's spit are the same ones in your tears and my water bottle, right? We're recycling these same molecules all through us, all mysteriously united, permeated with God incarnate, carne, God as meat, God as matter, God as flesh. The logic of the incarnation itself is what takes us out fully, biologically, theologically, God as the holiness of the world, one reality, not two. Just as the whole biosphere is animated with the living presence as word and flesh of Jesus Christ, so those creatures into whose entangled inner relationships we are spiritually and experientially restored in baptism, more on that later, are part of the assembly, receiving us back into communion. I propose, therefore, that our own incarnational theology insists that the creatures and trees and rivers and minerals of our places are part of the liturgical assembly, from whom we have been spiritually alienated for far too long. From this bigger liturgical assembly. That is, I'm proposing a much larger vision of that assembly, not just the Christian humans in a given place, but all life whose breath and movement the divine spirit pours out in creation, whose form and DNA the Genesis Johannine word sings into being. Christian ritual, I assert, is meant not to separate us perceptually and literally from this larger assembly, in our buildings and our human exclusive rituals, but it's meant to restore us to this larger kin in Christ, the full liturgical assembly of all creation. not how most people talk about the liturgical assembly. Gordon Lathrop has liturgical theologian, whose picture I also forgot to put up, has written an important new contribution to theologies of the assembly in response to this widespread move online, critiquing the shift from physical gathering into online surfing and church shopping. Quote, a religion that rejoices that God has come among us in the flesh must not support the idea that pixels on a screen are just as real or even more real than an actual place, end quote. But who comprises a place? It's not the humans only. What about the trees, the rivers, the birds, the air and insects and animals of all kinds? Or, quote, an electronic gathering too easily excludes. There are people in our congregations who do not have internet access or internet skills. The digital divide is real. Discerning the body means paying attention to this potential exclusion. Furthermore, he writes, in my access to electronic media, I don't have to deal with people who are not like me or people I do not like. The primary form of church, not me and my family before a screen, end quote. So far, so good. Go Gordon. But even this timely new work shares that anthropocentric blind spot, not seeing that in precisely this same way, an indoor gathering excludes the preponderance of the actual larger liturgical assembly. We can't be present with rocks and trees and skies and seas except outdoors with them in the birth, in person, in the body. If an all-white congregation had great racial theology and preaching and showed images of people of color all the time in their slideshows, but they never actually talked to BIPOC people in real life, let alone ever worshiping with them, we might think their anti-racism has a lot of growing to do. So too with our perceptual enclosure in buildings. This, I believe, is the new Babylonian captivity of the church, a bizarre species apartheid to which we're almost utterly oblivious. That's why it's a blind spot. We can do a lot of imaginative heart stretching toward the world and its life indoors and virtually. This extinction series that ISM folks are doing this winter, or the VTS series on lament, on eco-lament, are both online offerings that are powerful. But it's not the same as being present out there in real time with real creatures, feeling, sensing, hearing, touching, seeing, inhabiting, and being vulnerable. The furry, scaly, photosynthesizing thous of our place are essential members of the liturgical assembly, which I'm describing in a way that's not identical with the Christian worshiping community of humans, right? I'm talking about a liturgical assembly, a liturgical movement that's bigger, that's all-encompassing, to which Christian rituals return us, I believe, or should. So let our worship not continue to reenact and reinscribe our alienation by huddling behind closed doors that literally and physically cut us off from them. So thesis one, worship outside the church walls makes possible encounter with a wilder Christ whose incarnation embraces all matter, all beings. Thus it gives rise to more ecologically contextual faces of the divine. The larger natural world, including us, is the full liturgical assembly. Thesis. I might end up getting burned at the stake. Next section. The world is not just scenery or encountering this furry, scaly, photosynthesizing liturgical assembly. So my friends know that I've been saying for some time that the outdoor worship we need does not simply reproduce outside what we do inside. Chairs in rows, keyboard and sound system on long extension cords, human-centered text and languages and reading stuff off bulletins, but emerges from and reflects the larger human and more than human world of its place. This isn't merely a matter of being outdoors only, as if the trees and all that were just pretty scenery framing our still human exclusive rights, but we need to let our liturgical actions, gestures, words, symbolic elements themselves proclaim that these creatures are fully part of the assembly. Claudio Carmel Heist, I'm saying his name right, over there at Union, speaks along these lines of the importance of attending to the lex naturae shaping our prayer forms, how nature itself shapes us and our prayer, or ought to. Again, we're not just doing human worship. We're not just doing human worship outdoors. We're worshiping in wild new ways emerging organically from our relationship with these creatures. The Lutheran insistence on vernacular, worship in the vernacular of these creatures in this case. Our liturgies need to speak and listen and act in the language of the place, a language to which we've been deaf for so long we may have zero idea how to even begin. Our liturgies need to announce that we live and worship within this much larger cosmos of living, worshiping beings. They are our kin to whom we are finally coming home, to which homecoming the liturgy itself invites us. Or should Indigenous scholars and ritual leaders and many others speak of the urgency of Western Christian culture learning again what Indigenous traditions have never forgotten. To relate directly to other creatures of all kinds and species and to the forces of creation. As part of the broader world of thous in whom God meets us. In an outdoor Eucharist I designed in 2012 and led, we broadened the sharing of the peace beyond solely the human circle of those gathered to offer peace to the creation and to particular creatures you might encounter, this is from the bulletin, and the invitation to listen to God in them in turn. This action takes seriously the insight that God does speak to us through other creatures and creation itself. Again, a capacity and a form of knowing and relationship that might seem bizarre and strange to most Christians, but that invites us ritually into the deep attentiveness, humility, and mutuality with creation that such listening requires. This ritual act allows the sharing of the peace to become an experiential window into a new liturgical attentiveness to the actual voices of other species. Out of our human-centered bubble and out into the disorienting, decentering beginner mind stance of radical listening we so need. In the usual Eucharistic rite, sending and dismissal happens simultaneously with the exit from the sanctuary, being sent out into the broader world transformed. The sanctuary threshold, the lemen, first functions as the liminal boundary into this holy interior space by crossing that threshold into the sanctuary where social masks fall away, we hope, and psychic barriers soften into the presence of God. Worshippers enter holy ground. That's why, how it works when it works. And then in exiting the sanctuary across that same threshold, they go forth to live the identity and vocation received in this liminal place, experiencing their vision transformed. In an outdoor rite, though, worshipers cross that sanctuary threshold without moving indoors. In her book, Church of the Wild, Victoria Lures writes of crossing the threshold into a much bigger liminal indoors, in which all of creation itself is held, this vast interiority, held with all of its chattering voices and unpredictable forces, its vastness and fragility and particular local creatures. The fact that the outdoors can be experienced as fully liminal, as holy ground within the fullness of the Christian ritual experience, needs attention in our era of overwhelmingly indoor experience, our lives played out in homes and vehicles and offices and screens. To be in the unmediated outdoors, unplugged intentionally and attentively open to the actual bodies and noises and movements of the broader creation is an increasingly rare experience for many North Americans. To be so at the very heart of Christian worship is almost unheard of, except at camp. Outdoor prayer invites us to see what's been here all along. It's all holy ground. Our lives, sacred miracles on this vast, astonishing breathing. Here's a story. Near sunset on Ash Wednesday, 2018, I traveled to the banks of the Ventura River outside Ojai, California, traditional land of Chumash peoples. Arriving to stony, sandy terrain filled with charred stumps and twigs, the land coated with ash. Until recently, this had been a riparian zone, dense with willows, sugarbush, manzanita, oak, and many other plant species, along with countless reptiles, mammals, birds, and insects, part of the Los Padres National Forest, one of the most biodiverse places on Earth. But the Thomas Fire, then, but no longer, the largest wildfire in California history, had surrounded Ojai weeks earlier, roaring north, east, and west into remote wilderness areas and south through Ventura to the Pacific Ocean, consuming 281,000 acres, countless plant and animal lives and habitats of all kinds, and continuing through mudslides unleashed by torrential rains, killing 21 people before the fire was finally extinguished. As Lent began just a few weeks later, local communities still traumatized. I gathered with Chumash, Shinto, and Christian leadership and participants from a variety of traditions or no tradition, drumming and singing as people arrived. We also welcomed random hikers and a family with children drawn to see what was going on. The rite followed the general ritual pattern of the host community, Ojai's Church of the Wild, an outdoor worshiping community whose pastor, Victoria Lures, on the previous slide, coordinated the service. The Chumash elder, Julie Tumamayat, you can see her there, opened the rite, leading us in invoking relations in the four directions, inviting us to kneel, to touch, and open ourselves to the scarred soil and earth itself, and sending us later into the extended wandering portion of the service with offerings of sage, acorns, and other seeds to give back to the land, the water, the creatures, the place. I wrote and led a lament, naming the shattering devastations of species, a numbing cascade of losses. During the wandering, people spent time along the river where they found places of particular desolation or beauty in which to rest and listen. We returned for a cleansing rite, and at the end, Victoria and I marked participants' foreheads with that ash that had surrounded us the entire service. Our bodies received the sign of the cross in Thomas Fire ashes. The Christian season of repentance inaugurated with the ash bodies of the charred plants and animals consumed by drought and climate fire. Liturgical gesture and symbol, action and participants emerging from the place itself. Ashes not from last year's palms ordered online, but from the charred bodies of those plants and animals our fossil fueled lives have helped incinerate. Christian liturgy native to the sanctuary that is this place, in all its distinctive needs and beauty and beings, its interwoven body, heart, mind, species, interspecies life. What does such liturgy look like in your place? What kinds of gestures and postures invite us to hear the living word of creation here, to see and act sacramentally here? They will take new forms in every place. Skip a little on access questions and how these outdoor forms actually also open access to many people who would not ever come into a church. So questions of access cutting both ways. Extending our liturgical attention in this way, learning to craft new language and new forms of listening, will help us also in the urgent need to step up publicly into the kind of liturgical, not only ethical, public speech and language our earth and creatures need so much today, to call not just local, but regional or national or global attention to who's missing, whose homes are being destroyed, who is not just dead, but extinct. To collectively and publicly extend rites of welcome, of holiness, of ordination to creatures and rivers and whole ecosystems. Native Americans and Buddhists are doing this already, but the Christians have been overwhelmingly liturgically mute in the face of these mounting, cascading, sickening losses. As if we don't know, in fact, what to say in the face of death. As if we had no liturgical imagination from our centuries of tradition, as if indeed we consider glaciers and species and waters to be beneath our notice or outside the reach of our rites, as if indeed only humans were worth public ritual attention, the world's astonishing diversity of life forms, no more than scenery, backdrop, commodities after all. We may not think any of this theologically or ethically, but we announce it liturgically. through this massive indoorness of our liturgical practice, this species enclosure in rooms and buildings, rejecting our shared sacred life with the rest of the planet as whole sections and futures of life on Earth wink out. Liturgical gesture is powerful. We need practice week by week, learning the listening and gestures of interspecies life if we're to be able to step up into public rituals for Earth's defense and love. Second thesis, we need to recover a sense of literal and metaphoric sanctuary in the lives of ecosystems, waterways, local lands and their creatures, city trees and urban creeks. This is our sanctuary. Thesis three, our outdoor liturgical form should reflect this ecological contextuality, emerging from and reflecting the larger human and more than human world of this place. The fact that we live and worship within this much larger wild communion of beings. And the last two sections are quicker, I believe. These are the conceptual ones. The last two are immersive, sacramental. So immersion into divine presence. I've been advocating since 2015 for a return to the practice of the early church of baptism taking place in local waters, aligned with the baptism of Jesus himself in the Jordan River. Such practice immerses initiates in the living water the Didache calls for, a far cry from the ecological sterility of much typical practice. It provides the most powerful possible experiential richness toward claiming ecological kinship and discipleship at the heart of what Christian faith means. Let's see, which is not to say that moving baptism outdoors is easy. Questions of pollution and access make this practice much more complicated than indoor baptisms in most communities. Yet these facts do not somehow excuse us from this move outdoors. Rather, they demand our concerted action in the case of pollution with the same urgency we would mobilize if our indoor sanctuary proved contaminated. And they demand our creativity in terms of access. If for most Christians such assertions seem far-fetched or even nonsensical, so far do these ideas diverge from the factors guiding the normal shape of a normal congregation's practice of baptism, then that may be a marker of the extent of the alienation between our faith and the actual life of the larger natural world. Of course, I realize most places are not ready to accept the normative practice of baptism in local waters. Yet, I still believe this normativity stands. And in such cases, the intermediate question becomes, how close can we get to the baptismal river for now as we move toward full immersion? I have lots of ideas about that. So we started a little late, but I don't want to go too late. I have a story. I have another story. Do you want to hear another story?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Stories are fun, aren't they? This is from an article I wrote in the journal Call to Worship this past fall on outdoor baptism, beginning with the story of a 5-day canoe pilgrimage in 2018. Part of a larger 40-day River of Life pilgrimage down the entire length of the Connecticut River, beginning up in the headwaters of the Maine border and coming down through New Hampshire, Vermont, across Massachusetts down. So sometimes when I talk about this with people who live along the river, they know about this or were part of it. Anyone part of that experience here? Yeah. So this was this amazing project of the Episcopal Churches of New England and the New England Synod of the ELCA in partnership with two local land-based spiritual practice organizations. The canoe trip included some harrowing moments in the wild river. We were in the far north stretch. This was the second stage of the journey from Colebrook, New Hampshire to Lancaster, 5 days, 4 nights. So there were some harrowing moments in the wild river stretch, particularly one involving a low head dam, which we very, very nearly went over the top of, and only by frantic backpedaling were able to scoot sideways just enough feet as to not go over the worst of it.
Wow.
but also amazing beauty, companionship, and encounters with this place and its history, wildlife, and indigenous presence. In my article, I marked the transition into this the following meditation from the section on what I was just saying about advocating for the return of the practice of baptism to local waters with this sentence. Most forms of indoor baptism are in relation to this outdoor immersion, as the 45-minute scenic drive down Highway 3 from Coleridge to Lancaster, New Hampshire, is to our 5 days in the river in a canoe. I'm advocating for baptism that's analogous to the 5 days in the river in the canoe. So for now, imagine a parish near that Connecticut River up in northern New Hampshire or Vermont, or the Mill River near this campus. Imagine that the water is clear enough to swim in, to baptize in. Imagine there's a sweet spot with calmer waters, a little beach maybe, a parking lot and path, or a bikeway not too far away. Imagine you were being prepared for baptism into a Christian faith that takes seriously your living relationship with the rest of the biosphere, with the actual creatures of this place who live here with you. Imagine that catechesis involves learning many of these creatures, their names and habitats, their needs and voices and movements. Perhaps in preparing for baptism, the community invites you to spend time with them, or to let one of them mentor you and accompany you through this rite into Christian belonging. Now imagine that your baptismal ceremony takes place in this river you're getting to know, that the day is brisk, the water cold, it's a little breezy, maybe a storm is approaching. It's late spring, Pentecost, birds are everywhere, calling and flitting and feeding their young, buds and leaves and flowers bursting out in every direction. You wade in, gasping a little, and as you move deeper, you can feel the edge of the current of the larger river beyond the baptismal area, tangible, dark, flowing, rich. At waist high, you stop with the pastor, your sponsors, your friends and family wading in too as they wish. Others remain on the shore within earshot. Here with full voice, you renounce the evils that keep you from loving God, the world, yourself, other humans, all creation with all your heart. Here you claim the faith of a creation-saturated triune God, the vision of a world beloved and redeemed in every corner and crevice, the way of passionate, nonviolent, wholehearted mercy Jesus taught and teaches. And into all of this, the water filled with the spirit of life oxygenating the minnows and fry and larvae and nymphs and microbes, algae and mussels and fish and frogs filling this river, you are baptized. And you come up dripping with the bodies of these creatures and into the bird song of the place, a heron swooping past, a turtle sunning on the rock, your human community in Christ beaming at you and already taking off their warm, dry shoes and socks, their body heated garments and coats to clothe you in love. This is the baptismal reality. It's exhilarating, totally unforgettable, totally immersive. And if there is more danger involved than in this idealized narration, if it's hard, if unforeseen accidents loom despite our best planning and foresight, if the storm arrives more quickly and we're all drenched, or if not all those can attend who would like to, do these problems or even potential problems speak against such a rite? How does or should the ritual enactment of experiential kinship with the whole wildness of God's world rank in relation to safety at all costs? Or how much risky immersion into love of the world should Christian baptism make possible? Thesis. We practice a baptismal rite too often cut off from the living world, issuing in an anthropocentric, eco-alienated, and therefore impoverished vision of Christian faith, discipleship, community, and life. We need physical and ritual immersion into the flowing waters of our place, the fullest possible baptismal reconnection to the world's holiness and life. Finally, this is the quickest of all, Eucharist, mutual edibility. Or we are each other's flesh. So how realistic is all this? It's too dangerous, right? The baptism thing, all this stuff, it's too dangerous. This question takes us right into the heart of this final piece on physical vulnerability to the rest of the natural world. Christians cherish the physicality of the sacraments, the edibility of divine life as Jesus' body and blood permeate and incorporate ours. Much Christian thinking over the centuries has pressed the ethical implications of our Eucharistic sharing in the one bread of the poor and in the one body of Christ. But we do not as often ponder further how our body's edibility to other creatures, from wolves to mosquitoes, provides a similarly Eucharistic ethic of our species' participation in the rest of creation. Australian philosopher Val Plumwood is among those who've thought about this. In the wake of her 1985 experience of a near-fatal crocodile attack, somehow surviving three death rolls before managing to break free and crawl miles to rescue in the outback, Plumwood experienced her normal perceptual world collapsing violently into the primal physicality of her body being literally taken as food by another creature. In subsequent years, she reflected deeply on the raw shock of that, how she, like most contemporary humans, and she was an environmental philosopher. She had already thought a lot about this stuff. Nevertheless, how she, like most contemporary humans, well buffered from the natural world, had unconsciously defined herself as transcending the risk of predation. We are those who eat and are never eaten. And so our rites proclaim as well. We are always those who eat. And we give thanks for the gifts of creation and their permeation of our bodies, but we don't take the next step. For all its attention to bodies and opening the whole world to the whole world in sacramental beauty, even the most physically literal Eucharistic piety does not attend to the full physical implications of the Eucharist, now, namely how our bodies in turn become food for other creatures. If the idea of God becoming food and feces by eating the real presence was abhorrent to Ulrich Zwingli in his debates with Luther, the idea of giving thanks Eucharistically for ticks or wolves or microbes or maggots eating us is equally unthinkable to pest-destroying, corpse-encasing Western Christians today. We don't go there, ever. Certainly not in liturgy. Rites that tell the truth about reality mean, among other things, ritual language, here Eucharistic prayers, that break through our primal alienation as Plumwood's crocodile did to help us experience our actual place in the biological world. A shock, to be sure, for those accustomed to being at the top of the food chain, even unto eternal life, but a vision that is profoundly Eucharistic, filled with gratitude and grace. I can share pieces of a Eucharistic prayer I wrote along these lines. The Christian vision doesn't have to contradict biology by taking us out of this being eaten world. It could invite us deeper into this world, the miracle of it all. My body really is meant to be eaten, and my great hope is to offer myself to be literal nourishment back to the suffering paradise that is earth. I can do that by my body's excretion along the way. That's a different talk. And I can give back in endless ways in my vocation and my citizenship and my love for the world and its creatures, including humans. And at the end, I can become the main course for nearby creatures for a brief moment in the huge, glorious interspecies banquet that is life on Earth, to be fully re-metabolized into countless other life forms, no personal me existing in some future realm. But I can't actually experience any of this explicitly, interspeciesly, in any Christian Eucharist I know. None. I've done surveys. I've read. No one does this in Eucharist. I want to learn to pray being prey. To know this earth belonging in my bones, to receive precisely this interwoven interspecies bodily entanglement explicitly, ritually, in the practice of Eucharist would be awesome grace. Again, from David Abram, quote, our animal body blends into the wider body of the animate earth, this immense spherical metabolism in which our individual physiologies are embedded, upon which our divergent lives all depend, end quote. Final thesis. The incarnation insists that we honor our utter biological inseparability from all the rest of creation, part of the Eucharistic food web of earth's very life. The experience of physical vulnerability to other creatures is an essential dimension of a fully sacramental spirituality. Not something to be pretended. This is the fullness of presence. It is real presence. Amen. Spirit, my Lord. Thank you. So we have time for questions.
Thank you so much for this book. You almost made me an Anabaptist. Jonas Baptist. When listening to you and to your great insights, I always bought the idea of God and nature being one reality. I wondered how important actually is they are one reality in Christ. You build the bridge, the incarnation. But if I were you and I went through my shelves of books looking for a theologian helping for these insights, I would not have come to Bonhoeffer, to be honest. I would have come to Schleiermacher and thinking about the perception of the universe. So why this Christological way? Why Bonhoeffer in this?
Well, thank you. Could everyone online hear the question? Okay. So the Christological piece is the logic by which Christians can re-enter this wild communion, right? So like God and world one reality is clear to you, but it's not to a lot of Christians. And so the Christological uniting of God and world is precisely the means by which Christians get to be invited back in. Right? Does that make sense? It isn't to say everyone has to believe in Christ. It's to say Christians and Christian, I don't know if this is true, but it maybe it's possible that Christians are, or certainly Christians are uniquely alienated in our own ways. Not that we're more alienated than anybody else, although we might be, but we're alienated from earth in our own ways. And so proclaiming this Christological union is precisely the Christian means by which we return to a unified sense of the broader world and its holiness from which we've been separated. And Bonhoeffer is an interesting figure, it's true, and interesting also in that, so Karl Barth at the same time was quite clear that God and world don't mix. And he was very suspicious because of the Nazi paganism, and the Nazis were great environmentalists. And so we don't want to go down that path, and we don't want to have any blurring of God and world. And so Barth reacted to all of that by becoming even stronger in his reformed convictions of non capax finitum. So the fact that Bonhoeffer didn't do that is interesting, right? He was able to hold on to his Lutheran incarnational convictions, and he writes very movingly about the incarnation, about Jesus' flesh, about Christmas. He loved Christmas. And so he becomes a way through for Christians, I think. Yeah, but you're right. He's not someone people immediately turn to. Yeah.
I agree completely that Christianity has been too human focused and liturgically also. I'm not sure, though, that the division between human community and the natural world has been that absolute in centuries of Christian history.
Yeah.
Because some of that, I think, may be the, like, what's written in the liturgical books or what's in the, church councils talking about liturgy. But if you think of what's often relegated to folk religion, which was also Christian practice and prayer.
Yes.
So, and even sometimes the actual, so,
amen.
You know, I was in a baptistry in France where the baptistry is built on a spring, right? That's where the water comes out of the ground. Makes a big difference. It had walls, but it was where the water came out of the earth, you know? I don't think the walls kept you from being connected there. And then, things like dressing the wells, when you go out. And so I'm kind of wondering whether more of the problem, I think liturgy can be part of the solution, but whether more of the problem is that we don't live aware of our connection with the natural world. So we don't ask our pastor to come out and bless our fields because, you know, what the hell, right? Or the river or anything. And that we get our food from far away so that we don't connect the food to the things that are growing around us, and that our ancestors far back didn't live here. So, you know, if I'm thinking of its connection, I wonder how much you're going to talk about indigenization of liturgy,
yes,
right? Because
yes.
when you say if you're in Japan, we want to use rice cakes because bread is like, as one of my Japanese students said, it's like hearing the gospel in a foreign language,
yes.
right? So, but that's connected to what grows here,
yeah.
right? But we're not connected to what grows here and we don't have stories.
Yeah.
So in the, like Thomas Christensen's An African Tree of Life. So it's using
yes.
in Christian indigenization
yeah.
of liturgy, using our, you know, our, the people who live here, they are ancestral stories about what grows here. Okay,
yes.
that's a short way of saying it.
Yes.
Well, so there are stories about sugar maples as the tree of life. You get to the end of the winter, you're running out of your harvest, but nothing's growing yet, right? It's right now, it's right. And how do you survive if you ran out of what you had from the harvest? This spirit of the sugar maple comes to you and says, you know, drink my blood, right? Essentially. So it's a deeply Eucharistic story, which we could all be using in our
yes.
Eucharist,
yes.
except it's not our ancestors. You know, we don't have that rooting. So that's like five, you know, comments. I know.
Yeah, it's okay. I want to respond to two. Can I respond to two pieces? Yeah. So one is, right, there used to be all these ways in which Christianity engaged with local folk rites, and a lot of that stuff was early pre-Christian stuff, right? That continued, like the spirit of that spring and
right.
the dressing
but,
of wells, and all of that was pre-Christian.
Welcomed
right.
and
right.
used in Christian way.
Exactly. So
yeah.
there was so much richness along those lines. And yeah, people yeah. were farming and blessing, and their whole life was saturated with ritual from the church, and there's a weird sense in which all we're left with is just the indoor part. It's like we've lost all that. We've
mm-hmm.
lost all that. All we have left is the indoor part. So it isn't. So that's what I was saying about, like, indoors and out can
mm-hmm.
be in relationship, but we've
mm-hmm.
lost that. All we have is the indoor part. And then
yeah.
add to that the fact that we're not indigenous to this place. And yeah, that sense of alienation is only compounded. And then food is, you know, you buy it on a piece of styrofoam at
yeah,
the supermarket or something instead of all that stuff.
Yeah,
and
we're
the
eating
catastrophe
bananas.
Of the
we're eating bananas.
Food system. Right, I know,
right.
exactly. Shipped in from, but, and so this question of how if at all, can people who are not Native American indigenize is a really important and interesting question. And to do that without appropriation, and yet we need, I mean, everyone is born in a place and begins as a baby in relationship to a place. And so can what would it mean to learn those stories? But it requires that kind of listening that, as we know, Native Americans did for centuries, and our ancestors did in Europe. My ancestors in Europe were doing that same kind of listening for millennia too. We just don't know what those were anymore, but we can learn again how to listen. We can learn again. And so that's what this question of doing ritual, letting ritual emerge out of the place was about, is about precisely that. Yeah. And to your point, you know, sugar maple as a powerful Eucharistic image that's native, that's indigenous here, would be really powerful, wouldn't it? Like, write that prayer.
Yeah. Oh,
and
I
have a friend who, yeah,
yeah.
Who,
and it's,
we have these conversations in the Ecology and Liturgy Seminar of the North American Academy of Liturgy, which I'm convener of. And one of the people in that seminar, as I was talking about baptism in local waters, was saying how the salmon run in her local Washington rivers, swimming upstream to die and give birth to, so this death and resurrection image of salmon would be such a powerful Eucharistic image. And so, yeah, we could be, our liturgies could be so rich with lots of metaphor and image if we just knew the stories. Yeah, thank you. Those are the, yeah, you were right, you had a lot. Super important stuff. Yeah.
I have a question from online. In creating liturgy, we often start by writing words, prayers, songs, sermons. David Abram has a lot to say about how language separates humans from the world. How can we worship in a way that does not use words to wall us off from the world, as our stone church walls do?
Yeah, great question. And And David Abram doesn't say that language itself walls us off. He says that alphabetic, phonetic literacy walls us off, but that oral forms of language can be very connective to the natural world. So onomatopoetic languages, languages that are very place-based, languages that that include reference to stories happening at this tree or that rock or whatever. So there's lots of ways that language can connect us to the place, but we don't speak those languages. We speak and we inhabit these kinds of languages, right? So assuming that this kind of language is what the question is talking about, I hear it as saying, how can we learn to use our gift of language also in ways that connect us to the world instead of separating us from the world? And how can we learn to use non-human language forms of listening and connection? Both. So I would want to just recast the question to include also human language, but in ways that aren't just words on a page. And again, I think we have to learn it by doing. I think it's about, I mean, we can be mentored from elders and those who already know how to listen to the land, and we need that. But like the trees will teach you, it's that kind of, what kind of speech is, does this place evoke? Yeah. What kind of song will we sing here? Instead of choosing a song in advance and bringing it here and singing it, what song? So like when I taught eco-spirituality at Trinity Lutheran Seminary in winter of maybe 2014, it was one of these polar vortex winters. Or like the week we were at camp, we were at this camp, it was super cold. And so the students had the assignment of, they were in groups, and each group was supposed to lead morning prayer a different day. And their assignment was to not just like choose some rite and lead it, but to run, you know, explore the whole camp, it was hundreds of acres, and find a place that was beckoning. Let that place shape the prayer that they would lead. So that also included the cold. So they were supposed to like lead prayer that didn't kill us all. they designed really remarkable morning prayer services. And one we were doing the 7 days of creation and kind of running between each day because it was so cold. And they had it timed so that when light came, we were watching the dawn and they figured out. So that was really awesome, and other stuff like that. So how does the place itself evoke prayer is a way I might turn the question back, along with what forms of language connect us rather than separating us? How can we learn to speak those? See if that helps. See if the person online, that gets at what they're asking. Person online, does that get at what you're asking?
Lisa, it's me, Sharon, asked it. Yeah. So it's good.
Yeah. Thanks. Yeah.
I mean, it helps a little maybe to think of ritual not primarily as a bunch of words on a page, which is the American, you know, So if you at least think of movement
this is a nice moment to put in my pet peeve about verbatim bulletins where everything is printed out, and instead learn to preside where you're evoking people like, do you renounce? If so, please answer, I do, or whatever. People don't have to read along like this, which puts you into a different part of your brain than if you're just actually dial. And then you can also riff on this. You can say, do you renounce all kinds of stuff that is appropriate and that might be meaningful to the person or whatever, instead of it just, we don't have to be locked in and naming particular creatures in the affirmations and all that kind of stuff. So how can ritual, so when we do use language, to get away from the thing that this is what worship is all about. Like if you go to a movie theater, you take the screenplay and read along? No. If you go to a play, are you sitting there reading like this? No. Like we think it's words on a page. Sorry, that wasn't maybe where you wanted.
No, that's related, yeah.
Sorry, that was a little sidebar. So what do you think? Is the larger natural world the liturgical assembly, or is that too much, too weird? Is baptism in local waters the paradigmatic form of Christian baptism? Or is that,
I think I've expressed the desire to be baptized in natural water and gotten some really strange looks. So I feel just very moved by your presentation that you're bringing this into the space.
You can ask.
Yeah.
I don't know if I can form what I'm thinking, but yeah. One of the framework for what you said is what do we like give up?
Yeah.
Or what?
Yeah. What's lost?
So I guess I'm wondering about boundaries and safety.
Yep.
That really captured when you said safe and wild. Yep. Like, is safety a value? Yeah. Are boundaries ever a value?
Yes. Yes.
How do you think about evil?
Yeah.
Yeah. So if you're renouncing things, what do you like? We shouldn't renounce mosquitoes, you know, but we don't like them, you know. So just.
Right.
Thinking about question. That piece
yeah.
of it.
Yeah. And we do need boundaries, and we need, like, we would die if people die on the streets, right? People need, we need shelter in order to sleep safely. We need protection. We need a sense of home. We need to be able to let down our guard sometimes and not be constantly like, what's going on, where's, you know, right? And it's not the case that the natural world is like foreign, and we have to go to the built environment to feel safe and at home. And many people feel safer out in the woods than they do on the streets of a city, especially women report that. But yes, we need safety. We need protection as well. Yeah. Just that when that is the paradigm or the reason for which we can't do these bigger rites, then it becomes a problem.
So God is safe.
Yeah.
But God is also not safe.
Yeah, exactly.
Right? Yeah.
We are confining this religion into very narrow little forms that are unable then to speak to the larger public emergencies we're facing as well, because we don't have practice. We don't even know how to relate to the natural world in a ritual way. So the Native Americans and the Buddhists are doing it, but not us. We're over here in our rooms.
So speaking of being eaten, mm-hmm. Thinking about what we do with corpses, corpses. I mean, that's a whole ritual issue too, about relation to
that. I know I took that all out. I had a little thing on.
Are you going to have a chapter on this?
Yeah. It's so important. And there are mushroom suits now that supposedly digest the toxins in your body.
Mm.
And obviously just green burial itself is awesome. Yeah. And
how much cremation is, on the one hand, burying bodies in cemeteries, if you think you're not going to ever use that land for something else, is its own problem. And that's one of the reasons why we've moved so much towards cremation. But it also, cremation, as we do it now, does kind of support the myth that I'm never going to be eaten.
Yeah, right? Exactly. And it dramatically reduces the bioavailability of your body.
Mm-hmm.
Like, why not just let your body be eaten? Turned earth. Yeah.
Can I ask about something how we feel about? Just to challenge you, I make a little bit of more anthropocentric point from tradition. As you might know, I'm not only a Luther guy, I'm also a Francis of Assisi guy. Mm-hmm. And if I think about the canticle of Brother Son, that the leading word in it to introduce nature is always per in the Italian, through. And I love this idea. On the one hand, it makes nature totally instrumental.
Totally instrumental.
Instrumental.
Oh, yeah.
So we use it to praise God,
right.
which is a problem. On the other hand, it is including also the nature into the praise of God, because the nature is made by God. So the nature is somehow below us, somehow above us, but not like in the image of gathering and on the same level as we are. This might be a different approach. How do you think about that?
Yeah, that's interesting. So the sense of nature being also above us is the part we've lost, I think. And that goes back maybe to the sense of safety. Like, we've made the world so safe for ourselves, and like, even people my age go, when I was a kid, we just played and there was no like being driven everywhere and bicycles and all that kind of stuff. So this sense of safety at all costs, and like nobody is ever going to eat me and nobody's ever going to harm me. And so this having a sense that nature is also bigger than we are is really powerful and important, because it is. And David Abram, again, uses this language of the more than human world, in which is important language, I think, for us to hold on to. Yeah, that's maybe similar. Yeah.
Maybe one more question.
Sharon has her hand up, so she could probably unmute herself and then ask the room, and we'll hear it.
There we go.
Sorry, it took me a while to get unmuted. Lisa, I have an idea that perhaps in order to allow the natural world to permeate us as humans, we need to get more comfortable with the whole idea of sensuality, that we have to be able to leave our rational minds a bit behind. And we also maybe need to repudiate reject the ideas that many of us, including me, were brought up with, that the natural world is somehow profane. It is not of God. And to see it as of God would be to worship an idol. And I think that still permeates our Christian thinking, at least on the lay level. Mm-hmm. And I just wonder if you could comment about that, because I think that may be what's behind an awful lot of our discomfort. And we talk about safety. Yeah, we're concerned about safety, but no, I think we're really concerned about the lack of safety in allowing our sensory bodies to receive and give from nature.
Yeah. Yeah. Both points, bodily worship. What does that mean? We don't know that. This outdoor thing is so sensory. There's so many different layers of complication and danger, but also of sensory connection possible, richness. And all of that is new. Yeah, we don't have language. We don't have practice. I think that's really important. And then the thing about, yeah, is all this just going to end up with worshiping nature and pantheism as the great or heresy? Like, I remember in seminary, I don't know if you had the same experience, feeling like pantheism, like I kind of went through seminary also with this sense that like anything that with a whiff of pantheism is automatically bad. Like, we don't even know why it's bad, kind of, but it's automatically bad. It's like the caricature of evil. It's the caricature of heresy. It's the contentless thing we have to guard against at all costs. And it's kind of that Karl Barth, this reformed way of thinking that drifts into Lutheran context as well. So how do we, I wrote a thing on, can earth be a name of God? Like, we call God all kinds of names, right? All kinds of names. But if you address a prayer to earth, if you call God earth, oh earth, we confess that we have sinned against you. Ooh, that's pantheism. Well, why? Why can't we call God earth? We can call God everything else. Why not earth, which is the source of our life? Why would this not be this fantastic metaphor for God, right? This powerful name of God to call God earth. We're going to pray to earth in our worship. No, can't do that. Like, there's this big N-O over it, which is really interesting. It's like primal. And so in this essay, I was saying, well, why not? Let's do it. And propose, that's where this language of second naivete pantheism came from. Like, I think we've successfully conquered the gods of nature in any naive sense. Like, nobody is actually going out there worshiping these anymore, sort of. Like, we've so successfully de-spirited the world that we're killing it. I think biocide is a greater heresy than pantheism at this point, in terms of like actual heresies that are actually devastating us spiritually and physically and our future. Pantheism is not the great terror that we think it is somehow, and yet we treat it still as if, oh, can't do anything relating to earth because tread into pantheism. So why not tread into pantheism? And so a second naivete pantheism. So no, we've deconstructed that. Let's try using this language in a metaphorical way, in a poetic, in a spiritual way, in an evocative liturgical ritual way, and see what happens. could be really powerful. People might come who aren't interested in the sky god thing, you know, who don't believe in God, but they could pray if we were using language of earth. So yeah, I think you're right, Sharon. There's a lot of fear about that. There's a lot of fear about that. It's kind of primal. It's something to do with, yeah, lots of levels. Anti-body, anti-woman, or mother, female, earth connections.
Well, thank you, Dr. David, for uncovering and recovering different aspects of our spirituality related to beyond insight. Yeah. Thank you very much.